So I've been out here, just coming in to add an interjection. I didn't record my audio for this gameplay, but I still wanted to use it because I think it demonstrates a few things with Clown with my standard build. So I'm going to just be interjecting sometimes to maybe discuss a play or go over what was going on in my brain at the time. Still hope you guys enjoy. Maybe this format will work sometimes, maybe it won't. We'll see. So we got a bit lucky here by finding them in the main room. My general plan on RPD is to go to one side of the map and keep it pretty much secured. And I chose this side because there was four gens over here, so that's why I chose to go this way. So we got really lucky there on about three fronts. First off, the first survivor took us in the direction of Kate, which my cigar box let us see. Secondly, the Kate ran away from the pallet that was in that room, even though it's a pretty unsafe pallet and pretty easy to mind game. And thirdly, she dead-hearted way too early and in the wrong direction. She went a bit of an angle, which let us catch up way easier without needing to throw another purple bottle. So after I got the hook, I saw through the barbecue and chili that there was two survivors working on gens on the other side of the map. Like I said, I'd like to cut this map in half, so basically my patrol is what you're seeing there, me going around upstairs and back down to the main building, or the center area, which let me catch that one survivor off guard. I'm not sure why Meg went the way she did, but she ran right into me and let me get a quick hit on her, which, while it does lead to the unhook, it does let me catch a few other survivors off in just a minute and waste time with both of them needing to heal. Now, a few things here, why go after the Claudette instead of the Kate. Well, mostly because the Claudette was going for a loop that I feel a lot more comfortable going to, which she does predict very well, and is anticipating it. And two, because the Kate now has to go to the other side of the map to try and get a heal because she didn't have a med kit. Unless a boon is up, which I didn't hear one, so I feel like it worked out in the end. Now right there, we just saw the power of Cigar Box, letting me know what the survivor is doing exactly. Now, I'm pretty sure she got a little messed up because of the glyph. I think the glyph showed up and she was trying to hit spacebar on the vault and instead it hit that. So that's a little bit of a just unfortunate situation for her. But it still worked out for us. We would have got the hit with the bottle and on the window. It would have been a medium vault at that distance. Now, the barbecue and chili from the Claudette there let me know exactly where the other ones were, and it was on the side of the map that I was trying to get to. While it wasn't a scourge, it didn't give me any regression. I did see the one healing, so I knew someone was still injured and she was pretty close, and saw that once I was heading over there, she started running for the hills. The other one was a little far away, and Cigar Box once again letting me know exactly where to go. I did miss one bottle, but it did wind up working itself out in the end and got me pretty decently quick down. Right there, basically just using a trick to with Cigar Box where you can hide behind corners, basically. It really can throw survivors off guard, because while you're still in chase, your terror radius doesn't matter too much, oblivious or not. They know you're there, but they don't know exactly where, how close, or how far for the most part. So it can let you get some really nice hits that way that they're not expecting when you did just pop out of the corner. It's a really good trick you can use on Shaq as well. Just hit up the corner, try to hide behind it, make sure your red stain isn't showing, and just go for it from there. Normally, the survivors will run right into you. Now that right there, just showing off the aura reading powers of Cigar Box, it let me know that they were healing up back over there still, that they didn't move, and it let me get Nancy down pretty quickly, Kate down pretty quickly, pretty fast. And it also let me know exactly where Claudette was, and let me pop out and get a kill on her, or a hit on her. She also played it very smart by just kind of waiting there and seeing what happened, which is usually what you want to do against a clown regardless, and most killers, to be fair. And then Nancy and Kate. Kate got a really good unbreakable play there, where I was about to Mori her, and she immediately did unbreakable, got up and ran away, and it really, really did throw me off. You can see me kind of stutter for a second there with my movement. So that play basically came down to a few things. Cigar box letting me know they were right there healing. Also, the one person did lead me right to them. The survivor deadhearting for distance as an altruistic save with a pallet, and me going to the right instead of the left, but pointing to the left, which made them think I was going to go that way, and save the best for last stacks, which honestly kind of got me that second hit extremely quickly. Normally, 4 is really all you need on Clown. You don't really need too many more. The rest is just kind of icing on the cake. 4 typically is enough for you to get it down pretty quickly because of the power of the purple bottles. So there, I heard the grunts of pain after following the scratch marks all the way there. Cigar box also kind of gave me a little bit. I think I missed the visual cue of the auras somehow. And then once I hit the other one unexpectedly, because I'm assuming they still have plaything on them at the moment, but they had no idea that I was coming, which is one reason why I super like plaything with cigar box. It's such a good combo, knowing exactly where they are and they having no idea where you are till they see you. And then they just let me get the Mori and the final kill on them and then get another hook shortly after. So that entire series of events basically came down. I got the hook, I saw the barbecue and chili auras, I went that way. I saw Meg go for the totem and immediately hit her. She probably didn't even know I was there. She wasn't looking at that door specifically because of plaything. I went for the Meg and then I chased her down a bit. I had some time to spare, so I just kind of watched where she went through the floor. And then I wrapped back around because I assumed she was going back for the totem since she still didn't know if I was on her and probably thought I was off of her. And then it paid off to a degree as she went through the other room and out to the left. I tried it, I was ended up alone. Once again, Hex Plaything coming in very clutch there. Because she was oblivious, she still had no idea exactly where I was. She can kind of hear me throwing bottles and had a general idea, but she didn't know I was right behind her. I assumed she was looking through every doorway. Hex Plaything works really, really well on indoor maps like RPD, and it kind of makes them less of an issue for clowns, since he can kind of get sneak attack hits and make him a pseudo stealth killer until they're cleansed. And if they do want to cleanse them, it does count as some slowdown, which can help you out tremendously in getting the snowball going. So, since Meg tried to get the plaything twice already, I assumed that's exactly where she was going after they healed up, so I just headed back that way. And as far as what happened after that, she kind of made the mistake of dropping down, and I made a huge mistake because I hugely, hugely telegraphed the direction I was going to go for the cutoff, but she didn't account for it. I'm assuming she was too scared of me following right behind her since she was right at the door, so she probably thought I was very, very close. So let me get the hit on her on the stairs, which I'm sure she wasn't expecting as she was looking behind her. So, the next little bit, because this was an extremely long game, I was actually looking for Claudette because she was the only one not on Mori at the moment, I believe. And I didn't want to tunnel Nancy right off the hook. I know with how long this lasts that it could have not been considered tunneling, but I just really wanted to get Claudette, to be honest. So, I'm going to cut a little bit to just the actual chases, and we can see if maybe we can talk about some stuff in those chases. I will kind of prelude this a little bit and say that the Nancy does escape, and I'll explain what she did. She did a really good job at how she managed to get out. So after looking around for about a minute, RPD is a really big map, as many people know. I finally found the Nancy. I kind of just got lucky she was walking through the hallway there. Once I did get her, I threw a bottle over the railing to right to where she would land and the most likely spot she would go, and then I would kind of cigar box to see exactly where she was heading to. I'm pretty sure she's still affected by plaything because she is still kind of creeping around to try and throw me off, even though with my aura seeing from both of my add-ons, it's not really gonna do anything. Thank you. So at that point, Nancy basically went into the office room, that's at least what I call it, with the palette. I was expecting Dead Hard, even though she did use balance earlier, so I should have noticed that, but I didn't. So she kind of just spun me until she was able to get to the palette. A little bit of a mess up with my part, but I did wind up catching her eventually. So I did eventually find a Claudette. She did a gin, and that kind of gave away her position since I can just cigar box the area to try and find her. What I did in the beginning section there was kind of use cigar box just to watch where she went, which is something that you can really learn to do with clown cigar boxes, and it can really give you an advantage in a chase. Just watch where the survivors go. Sometimes they'll just stand there, and even that can kind of throw them off if you wait long enough, because they'll kind of be expecting you not to show up from a certain direction. You can throw them off. And then at the end there, we kind of got her in a corner because she kept just holding forward and pre-dropping some pallets. And then she dead-hearted in a bad position. And then that just kind of ended the game there with her. So I just got hatch closed, which means that the doors are now ready to be open. And it's just Nancy left. I was kind of messing around with Nancy. I was pretty much probably going to let her leave at some point anyways. But she does a really smart thing here. I used my cigar box to kind of check out the area on both of the doors. I missed that first one. She might have been right upstairs there, which I'm assuming is where she was. And I gotta go check the other door. And what she winds up doing is the first door, she preps, and then she runs all the way to the other side of the map, making me waste time looking at that first door. With how big this map is, it allowed her to get out. And it was a really, really smart move on her part. And just kudos to her for that. So once again, good job from all the survivors, and I'm sorry for the lack of voiceover during the actual gameplay like I normally do, but I thought this would be a nice little thing to do considering I forgot to hit record microphone for this one. And I might try it again in the future, because it also lets me go over my gameplay and see where I messed up, because I did quite a few mess-ups here. I had a few auto-pulls that kind of messed me up. Should have lunged instead of swung, blah-de-blah, a lot of other stuff. But I hope to see you guys tomorrow. Keep the daily uploads going. Thanks for watching. Bye.